You have your Bible, could you please open it to Philippians chapter 2? We'll bring the lights up for you so you can see. Philippians chapter 2. We'll be starting in verse 12 in a few minutes. I like country music. I'm just going to confess, come right out and say it. I like country music. Before I moved to Texas, a number of years ago, I don't know if I'd ever listened to a country music song, but I'm hooked now. I don't know if you heard that they played a country music song backwards, and the singer got his beer, girlfriend, truck, and dog back. You hear that? I was raking leaves and pine needles in my backyard a couple of weeks ago, and I had my phone with me, and I had Pandora on, and I had it plugged in, and I was listening to country music on Pandora. And if you were watching from the inside of the house, watching me raking the pine needles back there, you would have seen me all of a sudden stop and kind of lean on my rake, close my eyes as I started to listen to this song that came on. I'd never heard it before. Then you would have noticed me kind of dropping my rake, putting my hands on my knees like this. If you'd kept watching, you would have seen my shoulders start to do this. I was sobbing my eyes out in 104 degrees, raking leaves, because I was listening to this country music song that I'd never heard before. The song was called The Good Stuff. I don't know if you've heard this song or not. In fact, come early next week. We're going to play it pre-service next week. Wayne's going to sing it for you. It's an amazing song about a young guy who's had his first fight, his first real fight with his young wife, and he doesn't know what to do. Anyone ever experienced this? And so he gets in his car and starts driving. He sees the neon lights of the bar on the corner, and he goes in, and there's no one else in there, and he sits down at the bar, and the bartender comes up to him and says, "What do you have?" And he says, "Give me the good stuff. Give me the good stuff." And the bartender looks at him and he says, "Oh, you can't get that here." And he looks at him and he pours him a glass of milk, puts it in front of him, and he says, "Let me tell you about the good stuff." And he starts to describe the good stuff, which is his relationship with his bride that he just left back at the house. And he starts to talk about marriage, and he starts to talk about being together over the years. And if you come early next week, you'll cry too, because it is beautiful. It is mesmerizing. It is deeply moving. I remember a number of years ago I was preaching, and you might have noticed I tend to cry every once in a while when I preach. If you come first hour, I cry a lot more first hour. I kind of get over it. And I do it less second hour. My mom was here a number of years ago, and she was listening to me preach, and I started to cry, and afterwards I was a little embarrassed, and we were out to lunch with my mom, and I said, "Mom, I cry when I preach every once in a while." And she said, "Pete, it's okay to cry when you preach. Just recover quickly. No one wants to sit there and watch a grown man cry. Just get over it and get back to what you're doing." Well, so I've learned that lesson over the years. It's okay to cry, but recover quickly. And so I went inside to get a thing of water after crying my eyes out over the song, and when I came into the kitchen and I saw my family, I started to cry all over again. I did not recover quickly this time. I was struggling in my recovery. My kids looked at me and they're like, "Dad, are you okay? What's wrong?" I mean, I was just sobbing. I said, "I listened to this country music song." "Wow, Dad, okay." Earlier this week, I got a text from our daughter, Annika, and she said, "Dad, I heard another song that will make you cry." I thought, "Oh, great." She said, "I'll play it for you tonight." So that evening after dinner, we sat down around the computer, and she got on YouTube, and she started to play this song. And it's called "I Loved Her First." I don't know if you've heard this one or not. But it's a song that a dad sings to her daughter's new husband on her wedding day. "I loved her first," yeah. The third verse is all about the daddy-daughter dance at the end of the wedding, and he's singing this to her, he's looking right in the eyes, and I'm sitting there with Annika just sobbing. She looked at me and she said, "Daddy, what are we going to play for our daddy-daughter dance?" I said, "Bohemian Rhapsody." And she said, "You'll probably cry at that one too, Dad." Yeah, I probably will. So I posted on Facebook, what country music song makes you cry? And I had 87 responses. 87 songs, or about 80 songs. My favorite of which was, "How Can I Miss You If You Won't Go Away?" Isn't that a great country music song? "How can I miss you if you won't go away?" There was another one on there that I listened to. "There Goes My Life," a deeply moving song. I cried again. Why are these songs so powerful? The reason they're so powerful is because they are about the beauty of true relationship. They're about those deep, intimate, loving relationships that we all long for. And when we get them, we cherish them, and these songs remind us of them. The good stuff is about good relationships, the good stuff of relationships. But not all country music songs make you cry, do they? Some make us cringe. They're of a completely different type altogether. A number of years ago, Hank Williams wrote a song. It's called "Your Cheatin' Heart." It just drips with bitterness. Have you heard this song? Here's some words. "Your cheating heart will make you weep. You'll cry and cry and try to sleep. But sleep won't come the whole night through. Your cheating heart will tell on you." Earl Thomas Conley wrote a song about the angst of being in love with someone who's not your wife. It's called "Holding Her and Loving You." "If she'd give me one good reason, I'd be gone. She ain't done one thing wrong. So don't expect me to just walk out the door. I still love her, but I love you more." Ugh. What a miserable place to be. You know, there's a whole genre of country music songs, songs about cheating. Kenny Chesney wrote "A Woman Knows," Carrie Underwood, "Before He Cheats," Patti Loveless, "Blame It on Your Heart." Yeah, blame it on your heart. Reba McEntire, "Does She Love You?" Tanya Tucker, "Down to My Last Teardrop." A lot of us remember Travis Tritt. "Here's a quarter, call someone who cares." Right? Toby Keith, "I Wish I Didn't Know Now What I Didn't Know Then." I mean, they're clever, they're creative, and they're all about the angst of damaged, broken, hurting relationships. I think country music is kind of like modern-day psalms. They put honest words to deep, authentic emotions. Either the joy of great relationships or the grief of damaged ones. And I know you've experienced this in your own life, too. You've experienced the joy of great relationships. You've experienced the grief of damaged relationships. And if you're smart at all, you're sitting there thinking, how can I have more of the first one, great relationships? How can I have more of those great country songs and less of those nasty country songs? Less of those damaged relationships. Damaged relationships happen, and this is what we're going to learn in Philippians today. The difference between those damaged relationships and those great relationships is how you view people. It's how you view people that you're in relationship with. So damaged relationships happen when I view you as less important than me. When I view you as a means to my end. When this happens, you're used, you're discarded, you're climbed over, you're trampled on. You are an actor in my play. You are a pawn on my chessboard. If that's the way you view people, you will have broken, fractured, damaged relationships littered behind you. Great relationships happen when I view you as more important than me. Now, the church in Philippi was planted by Paul. He actually spent quite a bit of time there establishing the church, raising up leaders, and then he left. And after leaving, he heard that there were some struggles there, and the struggles were really around damaged relationships. People that he knew, people that he loved, people that he had raised up in Christ were now struggling to get along together. And so the biggest reason he wrote the book of Philippians, the letter to the church in Philippi, was to encourage them to come back together. And in Philippians chapter 2, the simple theme is, I want to show you how to have those great relationships instead of damaged ones. That's what we're going to dive into together today. So look at Philippians chapter 2, verse 12. We're going to start with a very famous verse that's greatly misunderstood. Therefore, my dear friends, my beloved ones, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, the church in Philippi had a history of walking in obedience to the prompting of the Spirit. But now Paul wanted them to step into obedience in a new and fresh way. Now more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Now that little phrase, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, is many times quoted out of context, and it makes people afraid and tremble. And that's not what Paul desires to see happen. So let's make sure we understand what this verse means. The word continue is not in the original language. It's in the tense of the verb work out. And it's in the present tense, which is the present continuous tense. So what he's saying is, this is something that I want you to be investing in now, but not just now, later today and tomorrow and the next day, and really continuously until you see Jesus face to face. Continue to work out. Can you underline the words work out? Your salvation. The Greek word translated work out means to accomplish something, to carry something out. It doesn't mean to work at something. It doesn't mean to improve something. It doesn't mean to add to something. It means to carry out something. It's the same word that Paul uses in Romans 7:18, where he says, in my flesh, I have the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. Same word, carry it out. Gordon Fee says, and I quote, under no circumstances can this word be stretched to mean work at, as though salvation were something that needed our work, as in good works, in order for it to be accomplished, end quote. Paul is telling us that salvation is not something, simply something that we receive. Salvation is something that we receive and then we express. This passage is about how saved people live out their salvation. The way we describe it here is experience life. You experience the life of Christ in salvation, and then you grow in your life in Christ, you grow in your life with others, and then you express your life as Christ lives his life in us and through us. So he says, continue to express your salvation with fear and trembling. Now, you might have heard this text preached, and what the preacher says is, okay, you got to work at your salvation, you got to do this, and you got to do this, and you got to do this, and come up with a long list of how to add to your salvation. And then, if you don't, be very afraid, because look, it says, do it with fear and trembling. You should be afraid of God, because he's going to crack on your head. No, it's not what it means. It's not anywhere in this text, that feeling of God's going to judge me if I don't work out my salvation. What he's saying here, fear, phobos, can be translated fear, can also be translated awe, and some of the other translations you'll see awe. Trembling, quivering. The idea here is of quivering awe, awe-inspiring awareness that I do not live this Christian life in a vacuum. When I am alone, I'm not alone. When no one's looking, someone is. And the one who is looking loves me, is passionately committed to me, and is awe-inspiringly marvelous. So in this place of quivering awe, I will work out my salvation. I will express my salvation. That's what that verse specifically means. The question, of course, is, well, how will we do this and what will it look like? Well, we're going to look at the very first verse, word of this verse, Philippians 2:12, therefore. He starts with therefore, reminding us that he assumes we've read verses 1 through 11, which we haven't yet, so let's go back to verse 1, because the context is going to teach us how we can work out our salvation with fear and trembling. I'll tell you right up front what this looks like, okay? It's a very simple sentence, but it's the essence of this chapter. First of all, our salvation, we see this in chapter 2, verse 1, is expressed in relationships, we see this in verse 2, by putting others first. We see this in verses 3 through 11. Our salvation is expressed in relationships. How? By putting others first. Look first at verse 1, our salvation. If, or since, you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship from the Spirit. This is what theologians call a Trinitarian explanation of your salvation. If you look closely, you'll see all three members of the Trinity represented there. Union with Christ, the Son. If any comfort from his love, it's actually the Father's love. If any fellowship with the Spirit, Father, Son, and Spirit. It's the same kind of formula that Paul uses in the same order at the end of 2 Corinthians in chapter 13, verse 14, which says, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God, the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. So what Paul is saying here is if you've been saved by the finished work of Christ based on the love of God applied to your life in the fellowship of the Spirit, if you've experienced life, then we're going to keep going. If you've experienced life, if any tenderness and compassion, the word tenderness is the root, the word compassion is the fruit here. Tenderness means the inner source of emotions. We might say the equivalent in our language would be your heart. If your heart has been changed, transformed, dramatically altered, compassion is those emotions, those changes reaching out. Paul is reminding them that the Father, the Son, and the Spirit in salvation has given you a new tenderness, a new heart that leads to new sensitivities, new outworkings, new values, new life, new relationships, new attitudes. And those are the things that are going to be expressed as your salvation is expressed in real life. So our salvation is expressed in relationships. This little description here of being united in Christ goes on this way. Then, make my joy complete by being like-minded. It's agreeing in the truth. Having the same love. Notice it doesn't say loving the same things. Having the same love. Having God's love. Being one in spirit. It says literally sympsychos. Having like soul. Like souled, meaning our mind, our emotions, and our will are aligned with one another. Being one in purpose, thinking the one thing, agreement in mindset. What he's describing here are relationships that are in unity, relationships that are in harmony. Beautiful, deep, intimate relationships. This description, verse 2, is a description of good country music songs. That's what's behind great country music songs. The Bible calls that unity or harmony. I remember a number of years ago, it was when I actually flew up to Chicago to have a conversation with Scott and Vonda about coming to lead our worship and arts ministry here at Bent Tree. And I set up to meet them at the church where they were serving at the time, Willow Creek Community Church. And at the time, Willow Creek had just the most amazing worship and arts and music ministry. They were putting CDs out. I was listening to them all the time. And so I was really excited to meet Scott and Vonda. And they said, well, why don't we meet you at rehearsal, and then we'll go out for dinner. And so I said, great. So I drove over to the church for rehearsal. And I was assuming it would be rehearsal like they were up on the stage, and then I was sitting back there in the back row in the dark and just watching and observing. But it wasn't that kind of rehearsal. It was the vocal rehearsal. And so they took me back into this little tiny room with the other six vocalists. It was me and them sitting in a circle. Very awkward. And they handed out sheet music, and they all looked at their music, and I think the first time they'd seen it, they all started, and they started getting their tone and their notes and pitch and all that kind of stuff. And then the leader said, all right, let's give it a try. And they all took a deep breath together, and they started to sing. And oh my goodness, the harmony, the passion, the energy. I just closed my eyes, and I thought, I've died and gone to heaven. It was absolutely magnificent. It was so cool that I wanted you to experience it. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to pick five of you, and I'm going to have you come up here. No? Should we not do that, maybe? Maybe we won't do that. Because even though it is natural for us to sing. it doesn't always come naturally. It does for some, but for most of us, it doesn't. And the same is true of all kinds of unity. Unity is natural for someone who's in Christ, but it doesn't necessarily come naturally. Deliberate cultivation is necessary. That's true in marriage, isn't it? I mean, if you are both in Christ, it's obviously natural for you to be unifying, but does it come naturally? No. You got to cultivate it. That's true in your family, doesn't it? I mean, if you're all believers, then it's natural for you to be one and to be unified, to be in harmony, but it doesn't necessarily come naturally. You've got to cultivate that oneness. It's true in the church. It's true in your small group. It's true with your friends. So what Paul's going to do is he's going to show us how to cultivate this unity, this beautiful, deep relationship that he's describing in verse 2. So let me remind you of the outline. Verse 1 is our salvation. Number 2 is expressed in relationships. Now starting in verse 3, by putting others first. By putting others first. Remember, damaged relationships happen when I view you as less important than me. Great relationships happen when I view you as more important than me. Simple to say, not all that easy to express. The problem is, of course, our world encourages the you're less important than me mindset, doesn't it? Let me show you what I mean. I've got a little ladder here. Maybe little isn't the right qualifier. I've got a big ladder here. And I'm describing the what our world says is what you need to do to get ahead. Yeah, go down one. There we go. To get ahead. What do? You climb. You go up, right? And the phrase you've heard many, many times is the corporate ladder. It's not only applied to the corporate world. It's applied to many places in life. The corporate ladder says to achieve greatness, you got to get on top. And the reason the ladder is the analogy is because it's full of steps. And people know you don't just go straight to the top. You've got to work one step at a time, at a time, at a time. What they don't tell you when you're just starting out is that the steps are people. The steps are people. And so in order for you to get over everyone else, what do you have to do? You have to step on people to get above them. The other analogy that you might hear in our world today is the pecking order. The pecking order is the picture of the chickens in a patch. You put 10 chickens in a pen. It won't take long at all for the top chicken to start pecking on the chicken below it, and that chicken to take it out on another one, and the strongest chickens all peck on the weaker chickens, and if there's 10 of them, they know within 10 minutes who's number 10 and who's number 1, and poor number 1's got no one to peck. And it's like this in life, isn't it? We figure out very quickly where we are in the pecking order. We figure out where we are on the ladder. Okay, I've made it to right here on the ladder. That means those people are below me and these people are above me. I'm going to treat the people who are below me different than the people I treat who are above me. I need them to get where I'm going. Now, once I step over them, then I'm going to treat them the way I treat everyone else who's below me. You follow me, right? It's not just in the corporate world. It's true in our dating relationships. For some of you, each step is a person that you've trampled on along the way. It's true in marriage. We view ourselves in a certain pecking order in our marriage, right? And as a result, we have a damaged and fractured relationship. It's true in neighborhood associations. Have you ever been in those meetings? It doesn't take long at all to figure out where you are in the pecking order in those things. My wife, Libby, says it happens in Zumba classes. You go to a Zumba class, you figure out where you fit in the whole pecking order, or who the really good Zumba people are and who the people who are just learning, and I wouldn't know, I'm never going to Zumba class. I think the place you see it more than anywhere else is at kids' birthday parties. You invite your kids, all their friends together, and just watch, and you will see them just figuring out where they fit in the pecking order. It's the way the world works. No wonder there's so many damaged relationships. No wonder. So we get to verse 3. Paul says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Modern translation, don't spend your life climbing the ladder. Don't spend your life climbing the ladder. Don't spend your life trying to get as high as you can so you can look down on as many as you can. But instead, in humility, consider others better than yourselves. If that's not already underlined in your Bible, go ahead and underline it. In humility, consider others better than yourselves, or more significant than yourselves. So I'm going to go ahead and climb down to give you a picture of what this actually looks like. In humility, I'm going to consider others better than myself. Verse 4, each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. The Apostle Paul is asking for a paradigm shift. It's counterintuitive. It's completely different than what the world will tell you. Here's what he's saying. The world will tell you to look at everyone like they are less important than you. I'm telling you, let's flip that over. I want you to look at everyone as though they are more significant than you. We're going to change the way we view people. Why would we do this? Because this is how you work out your salvation in these contexts of relationships. You say, Pete, if you knew how important I was, you wouldn't be asking me to do this. Of course, you would never say that, but some of you are sitting there thinking it. And the reason you're thinking it is because you've already made it way up there, and most people are below you, and you kind of like looking down on them. Feeling pretty proud of yourself. Oh, the next part of this passage is going to be hard on you. Look at verse 5. I got to go up here to read this. All right, you ready? Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. Literally, it says, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. Who, Jesus, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing. Okay, so we start with Jesus at the top. Jesus is God. Jesus is at the top of the ladder. He's at the top of every ladder. There is no ladder in the world that he's not at the top of because he's God. And what this verse tells me is that even though he is God, he did not consider being at the top of the ladder something to hold on to. Instead, he made himself nothing. And one thing you'll hear young people say is you hear them say, I want to make something of myself. Whenever you hear a young person say that, ask them, why? Why do you want to make something of yourself? And they won't say this, but here's what they're thinking. I want to make something of myself because I want to get noticed. I want to be praised. I want to get power. I want to be successful. I mean, all that stuff, right? That's what's really behind, I want to make something of myself. Okay, let's think about Jesus up here at the top of the ladder. Do you think when he was in heaven, he ever got noticed? Do you think he ever got praised? Whoa, like amazing praise for all of eternity from these amazing angelic beings? Wow, yeah, praise happened a lot. Do you think Jesus had power? Well, he was the all-powerful one. Do you think Jesus was successful? He was the mere definition of success. Jesus got to where all you folks are trying to get. He was there. He always was there. And he did not consider that something to be grasped. He was willing to let go of it, teaching us that that's not the ultimate place to be. See, I'm saving you so much pain and struggle and effort if you'll just listen to me. Who, being in the very nature of God, did not consider something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant. So Jesus started to go down. Made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant. Being made in human likeness. And another step. Being found in appearance as man, he humbled himself. The word humble, circle that word. It's the only way that this can happen. He humbled himself. The word humble means to bring down low. To bring down low, to walk down the ladder. He voluntarily brought himself low. He humbled himself and became obedient to death. Doesn't get much lower than death, does it? Even death on a cross. Oh, yeah, it does. Death on a cross is the lowest form of death you can possibly find. So the highest of the high voluntarily became the lowest of the low. Why in the world would Jesus do this? Because he knew a very simple truth, and that is that if you want authentic, deep, rich, intimate relationships, you will treat each other that way. knowing that we would never hear that in the world. He taught it to us, and then he demonstrated it. Why? So that he could have a deep, intimate, rich relationship with us, so that we could have the same with one another. Verse 9, I'm going to go up again, just a second. Here's what happened next. Jesus descended. Therefore, see how God responds to this kind of attitude. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place, back to where he was, and gave him the name that is above every other step, every other person. Gave him the name that is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. You see this all the way through the Old Testament. You read the Proverbs, you see it over and over again. God gives grace to the who? Humble. And he brings down low the proud. So those of us who climb, Scripture tells us, he'll bring you down. Those of us who descend, he will raise us up. It's a completely different way of looking at life. So the question, of course, is how does this happen in my life? Because, okay, let me just verbalize what you're thinking. Number one, I don't really want to put other people first. And number two, even if I did, I wouldn't know how. I don't really want to put other people first. And even if I did, I would not know how? So we get back to verse 12. Therefore, because you just saw that, therefore, because salvation is expressed in relationships by putting others first, therefore, since you've got that, dear friends, as you've always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation, to express your salvation with trembling awe. Verse 12, for it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. Oh, I love verse 13. For it is who works? God who works. The word works is ergain, from which we get the English word energy. Paul uses this word 18 of the 20 times it's used in the New Testament. It's one of his favorite words. It points to this dynamic power that God has that he places in us in Christ. For it is God who dynamically works in you to do two things, circle them, to will and to act. Will is to want to. Act is to be able to. So if the two things you're saying in your head are, I don't really want to put other people first, that's a will question. And if the other thing you're saying is, even if I wanted to, I wouldn't know how, that's an act question. And here's the beautiful news. Jesus wants to do both of those things in you and then express them through you. Fee said it this way. This is fully in keeping with Paul's understanding of Christian ethics, which has not to do with obedience to a set of rules that regulate conduct, but first of all, with a mind that is transformed by the Spirit. God makes it happen, but he makes us want it to happen too. So if you're sitting there today and you're thinking, you know, a lot of my relationships are damaged. Last week with Philemon, we talked about fractured relationships. This is different. These are relationships we're still enjoying, and there's probably high times, but there's damage there. They're not what they should be. And what Paul is pointing you to is quite simply saying, okay, I want you to put that other person first. And your response is, I don't want to. I don't even want to. So our prayer starts with, Lord Jesus, make me want to. However far back you got to go. Lord Jesus, do this work in me. And then, Lord Jesus, give me opportunities in this person's life to step into places where I can lift them up, where I can raise them up and treat them as more significant than myself. Lord Jesus, do that through me too. Can you imagine the difference this would make in marriages? Just marriages. If we stopped the pecking order thing in marriage and instead looked at each other and said, how can I treat you as though you're more significant than me? Whew, revolutionized marriages all over the place. How different would families be if siblings treated each other this way, treated their parents this way, and parents treated their kids this way? Churches as well. I think it would be appropriate to end this sermon with a country music song. I'm not going to sing it. It's by Tim McGraw. Many of you have heard it. It's called Live Like You Were Dying. He said, I was in my early 40s with a lot of life before me, and a moment came that stopped me on a dime. I spent most of the next days looking at the x-rays and talking about the options and talking about sweet time. I asked him when it sank in how this might really be the real end. How's it hit you when you get that kind of news? Man, what'd you do? And he said, and you want to start singing, don't you? We're not going to sing. I went skydiving. I went Rocky Mountain climbing. I went 2.7 seconds on a bull named Fu Manchu. Okay, so the first thing he did was he did his bucket list, right? He went and he started doing the things he's always wanted to do but was too scared or didn't have enough time. I'm going to go skydiving because I'm dying anyway. What's the risk, right? But then listen to this next line. And I loved deeper. And I spoke sweeter. And I gave forgiveness I'd been denying. Philemon. And he said, someday I hope you get the chance to live like you were dying. He said, I was finally the husband, the most time I wasn't. And I became a friend would like to have. And all of a sudden, going fishing wasn't such an imposition. And I went 3 times that year. I lost my dad. See what's happening here? All of a sudden, he realizes, I'm not going to be here for long. Where am I going to invest my time? Where am I going to pour my energy? What are the most important things to me? Loving deeper. Speaking sweeter. Giving forgiveness. Being the husband that I wasn't before. Becoming a friend would like to have. Going fishing with my dad. I finally read the good book, and I took a good, long, hard look at what I'd do if I could do it all again. And then he went skydiving and Rocky Mountain climbing and 2.7 seconds on Fu Manchu again, which I think is crazy to do that twice. But and I loved deeper, and I spoke sweeter, and I gave forgiveness I've been denying. Someday I hope you get the chance to live like you're dying. I think the Apostle Paul would say amen to the content of that. But it's not only possible when you get bad news from the doctor. Paul would call it live because you're living. I mean, if you get bad news from the doctor, by all means, get your life sorted out. But if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you get to live the rest of your life this way. He can enable you to pour into relationships because that's what really matters. And if you will take this to heart, if you will ask the Holy Spirit to allow you and enable you to give you the desire to lift people up and consider them more important than yourself, you'll be amazed at what will happen in your relationship. Please stand with me. I want to pray for you. Lord, I thank you for my friends. I thank you that we got to be here together. I thank you that when we open your word, we don't just see what our world is feeding us rehashed in different language, in ancient contexts. We see something completely different. We see the world the way the world is supposed to be. We see relationships the way they're supposed to be. And Lord, I know that there's as many broken relationships in the church as there are outside, which is so sad. I think it's because we haven't learned this yet. We haven't truly surrendered that you might do this work in us. So I want to pray for my brothers and sisters. I want to pray for supernatural work in their relationships, in all their relationships. I pray that they would start to see everyone different, whether they're above them or below them in their perceived pecking order. Doesn't matter who they are. Doesn't matter if they speak their language. Doesn't matter if their skin color is the same as theirs. Doesn't matter if they make more money or less money. Doesn't matter if they make the team or don't make the team. My prayer is that we would see all people the way you see them, as incredibly precious. And as you did, Jesus, we would voluntarily lower ourselves and raise them up. Lord Jesus, do this in us, I pray. And I pray it in your powerful and precious name. Amen.